So I'm going to present you IME. So this is the second time that I'm presenting IME here in Lugano. So last year it was a prototype, now it's a product, so I'm very proud to present you a product and no more a prototype or a project. So I'm Jean-Thomas Coeva, I'm based at DDN Storage in Paris. So it's a product, so it means that it's running in production. So currently our largest configuration is in Japan, so this is the Oak Forest system. It's number 6 on the top 500. A 25 petaflop Xeon Phi system with Intel network and DDN IME burst buffer solution. So the bandwidth is about slightly more than 1 terabyte for both read and write, even on shared file. So we are very proud of this installation. So currently, this is our largest in the world. So just some slide about the product itself. So the idea is that we are going to add an intermediation layer between the compute part of the cluster and the traditional parallel file system. So this intermediation layer is based on SSDs with some software which has been specifically written, I would say, natively for Flash. So we are very careful about designing everything from scratch to leverage at most, I will say, the capacities of this device. So the motivation, of course, is that when you look at the numbers, the key performance metric of a SSD compared to one from traditional hard drive, there is a very large change. It's really like a landscape shift. So the bandwidth is much higher, the latency is much better, the capacity is smaller, and sadly, the price also is higher. So what can we do with an expensive and yet super fast technology on the CPU side? Since years, we know that, oh, when you have this kind of high capacity, I will say high performance, expensive memory, then you build a memory hierarchy. So this is what we did for the storage part. So we add this red box, the IME, which is a large storage cache, which is going to absorb the peak of bandwidth so that you can see on the red part. So the cache is going to ingest the right bandwidth and then slowly and quietly it will percolate to the parallel file system at the background. So this is for the data plane, and from the control plane, we still rely on the parallel file system. So we are not yet a full file system, it's still an acceleration layer. So it means that we need a cooperation with the file system, for instance, to create inode. IME is not able to create inode. It needs to ask, please give me an inode to Lustre or GPFS or whatever parallel file system you have underneath. Okay, so this is typically this slide. So in terms of software architecture, it's very simple. This is a client-server architecture, so it means that we have a piece of software which is running on every compute node of the cluster. So we have a small daemon, a DDN daemon running on. And this one is in charge of catching the IO traffic and send it over the network. So you have several ways to catch the network traffic, either through a fuse moon point, which means POSIX-like interface. So it's not fully POSIX compliant. We are implementing what we call open-close semantic. So it's very similar to what NFS is providing you. Or if you are really looking for performance, then you can go for the MPI IO interface, which is much better performance, much more aggressive, but then you need a bit of implementation. So once the traffic is sent to the daemon on the client side, then everything is shipped to the IME server. The server itself, there can be several discrete appliances, but they're all kept coherent by the software itself, which exchanges a lot of control messages in order to keep this server coherent. So when the SSD are reaching, I will say, some capacity limit, so because you are sending a lot of data from the compute node to this cache, we need a mechanism to be transparent, so we are moving back the data from the SSDs back to the parallel file system in a transparent way, and there is some kind of arbitration policy. So first we will try to move away the data which are clean, which means that it's copied from something which is already existing on the parallel file system, and then we synchronize what we call dirty data, so data which are only up to date in the cache and need to be synchronized back to the parallel file system. Of course, everything can be configured at the sysadmin or user level. So the key feature in terms of performance is not that much about using SSD, but I will say using a correct data layout in order to leverage the capacity of the hardware itself. So on the left side, you will see you see the traffic as emitted by the compute node. So it's something which be completely interleaved. So it can be a mix of small I/O, large I/O, different file. All these CPUs are writing data in a very chaotic way. It's shipped to the IME server. On this one, because it's SSDs, we don't have to pay for the seek time, pages, and things like that. We are byte addressable. So we are going to store them in a very efficient way on this electronic device. And then when we are doing the operation of synchronization, which means moving from SSDs to hard drive, these hard drives are very sensitive to spatial locality. So the server, the IME server, are in charge of rearranging the I/O pattern in order to build this very nice, compact bunch of data, typically 8 megabytes. So it means that here the hard drive are going to receive traffic, I/O traffic, which is friendly for its underneath structure. So this way we try to preserve, I will say, across the whole line, the efficiency. Good network traffic and also good efficiency at the parallel file system level. So in order to prove this, what we did is that we took a spectrum scaler system, remove all the hard drive, and we put SSDs into it, and then we run some IOR benchmark to see what is the impact of the hardware itself compared to the software layer. And this appliance is supposed to deliver something like 50 gigabytes per second, and when we run a bit of aggressive benchmark, so all the nodes are trying to write to the same file, we are only able to get 2 gigabytes out of 50. So it's, I will say, 4% efficiency. It's not very good. So the case here is that the software itself is the overhead. So this is why, I mean, this is a justification why we try to implement everything from scratch, because the legacy code has been really designed for hard drive and knows that you are dealing with SSD with a much shorter latency. You cannot afford all this fancy heuristic and distributed locking, page granularity, and things like that. So speaking about SSD, since this is natively on flash, we need to have a kind of expertise on this device. So one point which is a bit difficult and people usually dislike with SSD is that they have a limited lifetime. So you cannot write over and over. There is some kind of wear labeling. There is interface which allow you to monitor this, the smart interface. So you have counter on the device, and you know how many times you have written the device and how many times if you start to get some error. And as you can see, the problem is that as soon as you get error, it's an exponential. So it means that when you get a very limited number of errors, then you have a extremely narrow time frame in order to change your device because it's going to die very quickly. So on the left side here, this is what we observe when we are using the traditional endurance test. So typically vendors, they qualify their SSD using a random 4K write pattern. So it's a random small page. On the IME side, what we do is that since we are doing this reorganization of the data, we are writing by large chunk. So the question was, is it better for the SSD? We think it's better, but how much? So we are trying to qualify this. So we run the same pattern, but against the IME server, which is able to reorganize, reshuffle a bit the I/O stream. And we get the same curve in the sense that we have an exponential. As soon as we get some error, then the device is going to die. But the errors start arise 5 times later. So it means that here the device basically die when we write it over 1500 times. On the other case, when we are using the IME layer, we are able to extend the lifetime of the SSD over 5,000 complete rewrites. So I'm very conscious this is specific to one device, so I'm not going to say that we are going to extend all SSD lifetime by a factor of 5, but at least on this device, it was, I would say, a nice result. So now we have to qualify NVMe on other drive. So we say it's an I/O acceleration layer because originally it was designed as a burst buffer, but we put a bit of engineering effort in order to improve the read performance. So we spoke a lot about machine learning these two last days. So here, so read performance are critical. So what we did is that we implement some kind of a sophisticated prefetch scheme. So the idea is that you try to detect regularity in the read pattern from every compute node, and based on this regularity, we try to anticipate what will be the next read access. So we have various policies, strided access, non-strided access, variable block length. So since it's software, you know, we can tweak it as much as we want. So we are currently we are running some tests, machine learning tests, where we need to pass a database of something like 1 million pictures like this. So it's, I don't know if we have to recognize fish or happy fisherman, but something like this. So it's a huge volume of data, and we need to deliver consistent and good read performance because at the other end, on the compute side, this is GPU, which are crunching data at a very efficient way. So it's a bandwidth issue, but not on the write side, but on the read side. So to be consistent with the title of this talk, few numbers about some experiments that we are running on brain simulation. So brain simulation is a very complex scientific problem. So 4 years ago, there is some paper about the simulation of 1% of the human brain using a coarse-grain brain simulator. And in order to conduct this experiment, they have to use a whole K computer. So it's 1% of the brain with, I will say, a limited accuracy simulation. So there is not a single brain simulator in the community. So depending on the granularity of the simulation you want to run, you go for either the cell scale simulator or maybe more like the molecular scale simulator. So there is three main simulators, from what I know, is that there is a nest, neuron, and step. So from the nest being like the largest, the cell one, which has a more, I will say, biological meaning, and then you go down to the nanometric scale. So we were able to run, to conduct experiments with IME on two of these simulators, so I hope to have the opportunity in the coming months to address the third one. So the first one, so this is a project that we did with Jülich on the University of Bielefeld. It's about NEST. So NEST is a simulator which has been specifically designed for extreme scale. So it's MPI plus OpenMP. And the pattern is that at every simulation step, at the end of every simulation step, there is a write phase where the simulator is writing to the file system the result of its simulation step. So we run three kind of, or they run three kind of experiments depending on the size of the I/O phase at the end of simulation, either 8 or 1 gigabyte. And if they go through POSIX, if they go against IME, or if they go against DevNull. So DevNull is basically you discard the data. So we are not keeping the data. So this is somehow the optimal performance that you can get. It's like pure computational problem. The I/O has been removed. So we are very pleased to see that we are almost matching the dev null, but we are still able to read the data. So what does it mean is that somehow we are able to remove the I/O bottleneck from the simulation. So of course, if the I/O bottleneck is just 10% of the simulation, we are going to improve the performance by only 10%, but then it's like reducing the complexity of the problem from something which was CPU and I/O to a pure CPU problem. So I guess the end user were very happy with this. So a bit of explanation why the performance of GPFS were disappointing. It's a question of load imbalance. So because there is MPI barrier at the end and at the beginning of I/O phase, if a single MPI rank arrives later than the other one, it's going to slow down the whole simulation. Why for IME, the big advantage that we have is that the response time of the system is much more uniform. So we are, the distribution of I/O latency is extremely narrow. So all the I/O occurs more or less with the same time, while on GPFS you're going to have a huge variation on the slowest I/O is going to slow down the whole simulation. So it's obviously something which is very bad for scalability. So we were only able to run up to 16 nodes, but so if you want to go to exascale, this is something that we have to address. And I think here IME was, I will say, relevant. So the second simulator that we look at is neuron. So neuron is a more, I will say, biological meaningful than Nest. So it's not the full simulator, it's a mini app. So mini app is currently quite trendy in the community. So when you want to evaluate the performance of a system, instead of taking the whole application, which can be, in the case of neuron, 500,000 of line of code with very complicated workflow and things like that, you take a small application, few thousand in this case, which is going to capture most, not all, but most of the behavior of the full simulator. And then when you qualify a solution, you have a quite, I will say, accurate idea about what you will get as a performance on the real system with a real application. So here again, we get extremely good results. So it has not been published yet, so I'm not going to enter into the detail, but if you go to ISC in June, you will have the numbers. So just one slide about the notion of bandwidth versus latency. So what we observe with the IME is that at some point we are removing part of the I/O bottleneck somehow. As soon as you are able to overlap the I/O by the computation, then the bandwidth is meaningless. So it does not matter if I can get 200 or 100 gigabytes per second, as long as the bottleneck is becoming the CPU. So I will advocate for a bit more, I will say, complexity in the metric of our storage system, and not just put in front bandwidth as the only numbers, but also latency. So DDN was mostly known, and is still, I hope, well known for its massive appliance. So it's a huge, big iron, half a ton each of them. It's able to deliver good performance, power supply, and blah, blah. And with the IME, there is a shift where we try to go for something a bit lighter. So we try to go to something which is more focused on a software. So as for instance, here at CSCS, we had the pleasure to deploy the IME solution on hardware which was built by the CSCS team. So it was really like a software solution. On my last on the advertising slide, about ISC, so if you want to communicate about your work about I/O and storage, we have a very nice day dedicated to this. So you have two workshops, and you have still a few days to submit some communication if you want to take this as an opportunity to present your results. So any question? Yes. Yes, yes. So either it can be triggered explicitly by the end user, the sysadmin, or also when you can set a threshold, a watermark on your system, saying when my SSD are filled up to 70%, then I start to move data from the SSD to the parallel file system. I mean, yes, on the server, you need to have a bit of computing power and also a bit of memory in order to maintain most of the metadata in core. So typically, the IME server is, for instance, a Lustre client. So you have LNET running on the IME server. And is using RDMA, yes, everything is over IB or OPA.